are really consistent with sewer. Rest area is a lot, lot lighter than Glen has, and so you tend to know what they're gonna do there. There are a lot of energy in terms of carting around weight. Rest area tanks might take a few minutes to refill as opposed to several hours for typical intensive batteries. Using this compressed air would reduce the volume of lead acid, the volume of batteries that are on a scooter by significantly.
All right, so what we see here is a little bit of a map to figure out just how much energy is in compressed air. So, upon doing a little research, we found the proper formula for an isometric system.
Is that right?
No, isothermal. Isothermal, which means we are not keeping the heat constant, is this formula over here, where change in work is equal to the pressure times the volume of the container times the natural log of the pressure of the ambient air over the pressure of the tank. When we take that and our values are calculated from converting U.S. customary to metric, we end up with around 43,000 joules. And since a watt is a joule per second, we take our quarter horsepower motor, which comes out to around 186 watts, and figure out that, assuming everything is absolutely perfect, in theory, we get this thing to run for about 3 minutes, 48 seconds off of 2 paintball tanks. Or 4 paintball tanks, rather. The next thing to consider is energy intensity, or just how efficient the one particular fuel source is. In this case, we are assuming using a scuba tank, which is what we wanted to use initially, but due to budget constraints, we unfortunately could not acquire us. First things first, we need to find the energy of the compressed air in the scuba tank. Same formula as last time, over here, except this time we get 2.2 million joules, so a lot more energy. Much larger space to store. Next, to get the mass of the air, we take this formula over here, which is a funny rearrangement of the ideal gas law, which is PV equals nRT, except instead of having n for moles, we have m for mass. Plugging the values in, we get around 5 kilograms. Add in the 10 kilograms in the tank, and we get 15 kilograms for the altogether for the mass of the system. Do that, it comes down to around 150 joules per kilogram. As a point of reference, a lead-acid battery has an energy density of 90 joules per kilogram. So already we can see that, you know, in theory, the potential is there for efficiency. It's not the best, but it's also not the worst. It's better than lead-acid.
So the main concept behind our design was to use the energy that's stored in compressed air. We can direct that into a turbine, and that will generate electrical current that we can use to power many electrical systems that are on the scooter. We have a battery in place just simply as a backup in the event the turbine should fail. The turbine's able to produce enough electricity to power the scooter forward on its own. Ideally, all of this is controlled by a smaller onboard computer that will keep track of things like pressure and voltages at different points in the system. The real purpose of this is just to keep track of how much air we have left in the system, how much fuel we might have, and just give you an idea of the system functionality as a whole. So there's three of us. We split this project into three different smaller parts. There's an air system, an electrical system, and we have a user display system. I'm in charge of this air system, supplying compressed air to a generator. Dillon is taking that air, converting it into electricity, and Ian is going to take the data, monitor that from the system, and ideally convert that into information that can display onto an LCD screen. My own individual system is broken down into three parts. Portable source of high pressure air, a good way to release that air safely at the correct pressure consistently, and I need a good way to control how fast that air is flowing into our system. So the idea for this design is mainly to direct high pressure air from a smaller tank into a pressure regulator. This is going to deliver a set pressure to a valve, which will control the speed, increase or decrease the speed of the air as it's needed. This regulator can handle up to 3,000 psi and will output a small amount of pressure for our valve to handle safely. So as far as the actual air storage, we have access to EPCs, a couple of high pressure air tanks, commonly used for paintball, like Ian was saying. The These have to be adapted to fit the pressure regulator we have on hand, but we chose to go ahead with this anyway. The tanks fit our requirements really well enough to justify what we've adapted online using that. This will store a lot of air in a very small space, and that's really just ideal for our project. As far as releasing the air effectively, we've got a full speed of that air, obviously, as it goes into our system. Needed the valve that can handle high enough pressure to still output a consistent flow rate for our system. It's going to be generating most of the power. That's Dillon's part of the presentation. I'll take it.
So this is an overview of the power conversion system. So the whole system starts with the compressed air coming into the air motor, which is that one. There we go. That motor uses the compressed air to spin the turbine, which is connected to an electric generator, which is generating electricity for the motor controller that powers the scooter. It also simultaneously feeds energy into a small battery pack, not nearly the size of the one that originally came with the scooter. Probably could easily be, maybe, I wouldn't say maybe the size of this, but maybe a little bit bigger. Anyway, that small battery pack, that small battery pack can take, can supply extra current for when the electric generator can't supply enough power to the scooter, which is actually a bit of a problem that we can solve. So the electric generator is composed of more or less of these two components with a coupler to put them together. When we were testing the scooter to determine what kind of power requirements we would have to meet, we found that the scooter used nearly 1 horsepower to start with. Roughly 750 watts of power to start from standstill up to its full speed. But after that, we found that it only required about a quarter of the horsepower to continue moving. So we figured that we would only have to design the generator to produce 1/4 of the horsepower, and then the batteries that are in parallel with the generator can step in and provide the extra current while the batteries will provide the current if the scooter needs it. Usually when it goes from a stop to a start or when it's going to go. These two pieces, an air motor is essentially a piece of cast metal with two plates on it. And it's got, inside of it is just an axle with a couple of paddles on it. Fresh air spins it around. It's a pretty simple device. And it's connected directly to the electric motor over here. That is a 300 watt electric motor that very easily serves as a generator, and it's a bit oversized, but it does the job very well. Yes. We decided that this method of using batteries as a backup system for a smaller generator is more efficient because the 1 horsepower versions of these devices, the electric motor, are both much larger. Is very low power device, and it signals only output. The signal levels are 0 to 3.3 volts, and that won't work because the motor controller uses the uses inputs that work from 5 to 15 volts. And so I built this quick amplifier circuit that takes the 3.3 volts in and then uses the computer's power supply to put out 12 volts in.
And lastly is my apartment, user notification system. There are three key things to this system, the first of which being the pressure transducer. Basically, the way traditional fuel is it's in liquid form. And the way you measure that is simply by fuel level. That's great and all, but when the fuel is instead of gas, you can't really use that. So instead, the way to measure the amount of air left in the tank is look at its pressure. The transducer is the device that will output a signal based on how much pressure is being pressed up against the sensing end. That will send a signal to the microcontroller, which handles all the onboard calculations and code, which can be wrote in C. It will take those and output those to a LCD screen, which is the way the user can see exactly how the scooter is performing, both the way it is, was left to how far you can go or how long you have left. This is a really simple system diagram of the system. It starts with the air tank, which will output the pressure to the transducer, which will give it a little bit of voltage power to get it running. We'll send out a 420 milliamp signal to the microcontroller, which will in turn send out the updated values to the LCD display with proper information, given what the situation is. Two key things about this section is, firstly, the pressure transducer. As mentioned, very simple device. What's actually unique about the sensor that we found is that it comes in a variety of different specifications, but the physical sensor itself is all the same size. So I get a transducer that has a range of 0 to 10 psi that's the exact same size and will fit perfectly in place as one that goes from 0 to 10,000 psi. Due to budget constraints, we're stuck with only the one that we have, which is 1,000 psi, though it's something of note that we can do on this project later on. Likewise, there are a couple of things that happen digitally that are critical to the system. The first of which being analog-digital conversion. When that transducer sends out a signal, it is measured in, let's say, voltage. That's fine and all, but it's a little tricky to get a percent of just voltage. What the microcontroller does is convert that to a digital value, the number of bits, in which case, now instead of going from 0 to 3.3 volts, it's going from 0 to 4096 bits. And for those, we can easily get a percentage and work those into our calculations for distance, time, and whatnot. The other thing of note is data storage. It may not seem like much, but it adds an element of time to these measurements. It basically means the difference between measurement now versus measurement then. Those two values, or more, as the case may be, for the code, we can calculate how much fuel is being used within a certain time period, which is the difference between having, say, 5 miles remaining and 2 miles. This grade can't go to 5 miles, just an example.
This right here is just kind of a quick breakdown of how our design process went from start to finish. Obviously, to start out with like research and development, how I want to design a system, how I want to put it together in the earlier stages. There's just a matter of choosing components, ordering the right things, fitting everything for our specifications, and then just once it's all together, testing the design for functionality.
This last slide is our budget. The air tanks and the electric scooter are provided for free, so those aren't included. We've got, that's interesting. That wasn't there before. between the pressure transducer up at the top is definitely one of the more expensive bits, along with the air motor, which for a cast chunk of metal, you'd be surprised how expensive it is. Anyway, we've got, this is most of everything we've got, that we can spend money on. Adapters, pressure control valves, motor controller,